welcome everybody. Several of our teams up here. We've already done ground rules, so we have an activity. It's early, we like to get people's blood flowing. So everybody here with a nursing degree, please stand up. And then everybody remain standing if you hold a certification. So next, stand up if you've ever considered joining a circus after successfully juggling phone calls, patient requests, medication orders, all at the same time. I'm going to reverse this one. So stand up if you color coordinate your closet. All right.
Okay.
Yeah. Color coordinator. And then lastly, stand up if you've been in charge of nurse for 1 year or less.
1 year or less.
One day. We've got our newest charge nurse in the room.
Drips, they refuse
introduced at the Tocqueville, their EP drops, they get transferred to Core West. Day 10, they continue to refuse lab, continues to be rude. I have inpatient pain management now starts on the SNF placement, discharged 2 to 3 more days. Day 11, plan A is SNF, there's no plan B, the patient wants to go home. Day 12, the patient prefers to go home via versus SNF. Patient refuses PT and resources, a cab is ordered for the patient. The meds are set in a separate cab to meet them, but that afternoon the patient gets into the wrong cab, is returned in the hospital. Meds returned, is no one is home, and the third cab with patient and meds to discharge. Does this sound like a typical thing that occurs?
Yes.
So this is why we're going to talk about multidisciplinary rounds, because this occurs. This is just one little story out of probably hundreds. So where's some opportunities?
Does it even have capacity to refuse?
That's a good question. What else? What else do you see when you look at that or hear that story?
They said SNF in the very beginning, and they never even, what did they wait to plan to SNF or day 10?
Yeah. Patients refusing care. We did a palliative care consult, but that was, you know, a few days in also. Yes?
You don't need to have a medically stable patient until they get discharged again. So waiting until they're stable is to leave and be concerned.
Yes. Anything else stand out? Yes.
What did the patient want?
Yes. What did the patient want? He told us right at the very beginning, right? He didn't want to go to the center, he wanted to go home. But we continued to still make plans and refuse care. So we probably had lots of opportunities. Something else, you guys? So this is our challenge.
So this story, like Ann said, isn't unique. We randomly pull these stories, right? The patients are randomly selected, and every week in our throughput committee, and I'll talk about that in a minute, we're looking at these cases, and we have not found one case yet that would have been an ideal admission to discharge. And that's one of the reasons, one of the primary reasons that we started multidisciplinary rounds again and did them and we're doing them differently, and we'll talk about that too. So next we have Linda Mathers, and she's going to present Right Care, Right Patient, Right Time.
So why is it important to have the right care, the right patient, the right time? And we're talking about this patient that we were just talking about. Why do you guys think it's so important? So one thing is every time there's a handoff with the patient, so every time we transfer to a different unit, you know, we're changing over nursing staff, we're changing over social workers, we're kind of reinventing the plan all over again, so communication sometimes drops off. So it's really important to keep that in mind too, as we move people around. Making sure that the patient stays in the right level of care, gets them to their goal as soon as possible. That has financial implications for us and for the patient. So trying to get them moving along the continuum and getting back to their level of care prior to the hospital stay is super important for the patient. We want to decrease risk of hospital-acquired infections and harm. There's many statistics, many articles out there that talk about the longer the patient stays in the hospital, they're at risk for so many things. Declining in function. Maybe they're not going to get to go back home if they've been here 5 or 6 days because they haven't been up moving and now their function has declined. It improves access to hospital services for acutely ill members of the community. So we all know in the last 2 years, as we've gone through the pandemic, that our community has also grown and our ED is always full. So keeping a patient in the hospital too long prevents that 90-year-old grandma that has a hip fracture laying in a stretcher in the hallway of the ED from getting a bed. So it's super important that we are moving people along so that the next person that needs services can get those services they need. And then it affects staffing. So every 4 to 5 patients that aren't discharged is another nurse. Especially with our struggles at night, try to fix in the hospital cost the patient sometimes extra dollars that they weren't planning on. An extra stay in the hospital might not be covered because it's their insurance doesn't cover that extra day. So it's extra cost to the hospital, but it's also extra cost to the patient. We want to be thinking about that, putting ourselves in their place and thinking about what's best each day for progressing our care. Any questions? Before we look at some data, I'm going to go through each unit and just look at where we're at on each floor. But any other comments or questions? Do you guys understand that? It's a tough crowd today. Every sort of way. Okay, here's the second floor, and I'm going to let Jackie talk about the data issue.
So we pulled data from 2019 because this is pre-pandemic, right? We wanted to see what did the hospital look like before COVID hit. And we can see, we'll see a similar trend on all of the units. This is second floor, 2019, January. We were sitting about 5 days, you know, between five and a half days. Here is March of 2020. So this is when we got our first COVID patient from the hospital. And then you can see all the way up, here's a peak, 2-1 of 22. We hit 10 days average per patient that month. And then over here is February of 2023. This is when we started our multidisciplinary rounds. So you'll see the timeline is the same on all units. So second floor, here is 3 North. And our highest peak is about 9.79 days. Of course, it's in the winter months. We would expect, you know, patients are pretty sick around that time. But back here, they started out around between five and six days. Here is OBS. We even had a peak of OBS patients staying 4 days. Fourth floor.
Like Jackie said, my name is Greg. I'm the assistant nurse manager for care management. First, I wanted to start off by thanking you guys for your partnership during the NDRs. I know there were some sticky moments during the transition, particularly on floors that already had successful rounds going. So I know that that was an adjustment, and I wanted to thank you guys for your buy-in and flexibility and your participation. So something that you might have heard at rounds is when care management said they have to eval a patient. So every patient that gets admitted to the hospital We do an admission evaluation to see what their prior living situation is and what their needs might be, and start the discharge plan. We started to notice that with the long wait times in the ED, we were missing opportunities and entire days of discharge planning that could get done. So we set a goal to have the admission evaluations done within the first 24 hours. Because patients will sometimes sit down there for 24 to 48 hours and then we aren't doing anything before they get up there, get up to your guys' units. So we hired some travelers to trial this and see how it would go to have kind of like a bunch more staff floating around doing these evals throughout the hospital and in the ED. And as you can see, in April, we hit 90%, and we started to notice that it really made a difference. Before they even got to the unit, there were some discharge interventions that could get done. We had an idea of what their living situation looked like and what their needs might be. And so we have now, most of the travelers' contracts have ended, and we are training 10 new care managers and beefing up our staffing so that we can keep this process going. And our goal is 80%, and we, at the end of April, still managed to maintain 78%. The travelers all ended kind of the first week of May, so I think currently we're sitting at like 51% because we've still got some staff in orientation, but hopefully we'll see that rise again. And then on the next slide, we've started auditing our care managers' handoffs to see if they're discharge plan A matches the patient's prior living or where they came from. It's always best to try and get the patient back to where they were living before they came to the hospital, whether that's the same level of care at a facility or their home. Studies show that people do better when they are working towards going back to their prior living rather than a different level of care. So we've started auditing that. Our goal is 77% for that because the physician progression, the MD progression piece, their goal is getting 77% of patients out within that 0 to 4 day admission window. And so we wanted to align the numbers. And the data that someone much smarter than me pulled showed that if we get 77% of our patients out within that first 4 days, then we will meet our GMLS on a regular basis. So that's why that's their goal. And then I wanted to, when we started doing the rounds, it became very apparent that care management's job is kind of a mystery to a lot of people. They don't really know what we do or what we work on behind the scenes and in our offices. So I just kind of wanted to go through a few things with you guys and kind of talk to you, because when we go home at 4:30, there's a lot of opportunities for afternoon and evening discharges. And so hopefully this will kind of help you guys not only understand our role, but empower you to kind of put some discharge planning into your units as well on the off hours. So for home health, patients don't need to have a PT and OT recommendation for home health. They can go home, and when you do the home health order, that will be their evaluation in the patient's home. So if the patient's already planning to go home and they don't want to go to the SNF, you don't need to wait for PT and OT to say it's okay for them to go home. We always want to support the patient's preferred discharge plan. They have to have a current PCP to be able to go home with a home health order. Some home health companies will take like a future appointment. So if you like schedule a PCP appointment for a new provider in the next month or so, some of them will take that. CMAR right now is kind of our go-to for a lot of patients with social challenges for follow-up appointments, but there's 30 to 60 days out. And so home health companies will kind of back off on accepting those appointments because they're so far out. But that can be a barrier to doing home health. Home health companies also take into account where the patient lives. So if the patient is a hoarder or doesn't have safe living situations or like there's family members that cause problems, home health companies will want to follow those patients. I know we tried on one, I think it was on 7, because 7 gets all the trauma patients. We tried for a while to get a home health company to see a patient that lived in a shipping container, and they don't. They will not do that. They have to have a pretty secure living situation. The other thing that I like to talk about with patients when I'm talking about home health is that you can fail home health. So you can refuse a SNF and we will never send you somewhere that you don't want to go. But if the next option or the best option for you is home health, and there's a question of whether or not home health is going to be able to meet your needs, I always like to tell the patient, if home health shows up and they feel like your needs are too great, then you'll fail home health and they'll probably send you back to the hospital for stent placement. So we always want to support what the patients want, but I try to give them as much information as possible so it's not a nasty surprise when home health shows up and says, you need too much care, or you need more PT and OT, you need to go to a SNF, because then we've not given the patient all the information that they need. On the next slide, it's often confusing about whether or not patients can go to a SNF or why they're allowed to go to a SNF and some are not. So some things that are good to just keep in the back of your mind. If someone's walking more than 100 feet, they won't qualify for SNF insurance, won't pay for it. If they have not had BM in the last 2 days, the SNF will require a BM before they'll accept the patient. Otherwise, they'll just send them back to the ED for consultation when they show up. If they have COVID, it's kind of a case-by-case basis. Some SNFs will not take new infections. They will only take patients who might have been at their facility and then come to the hospital, either that had COVID and that was the reason they came to the hospital, or they were known to have COVID while they were at the facility. If they're actively using substances, oftentimes SNFs will not take patients doing that. If they're using substances in the hospital, like family is bringing in some like adjunct pain medicine for the patient, that's not something that SNFs will accept either. If they have behaviors, if they're agitated, violent, we've seen SNFs deny people just because they're noted to be screaming constantly throughout the day. So it's really important when we are talking at rounds and you have patients like that to document behaviors, whether they're positive or negative, so that we can give our partners in the community the most realistic picture of what the patient is. We wouldn't like it if someone misrepresented a patient's behavior to us and then showed up on our unit, so we try not to do that to facilities and adult family homes as well in the community. If they are requiring a telesitter or they're on restraints or need a one-to-one, they will not be able to go to a SNF until that's discontinued. When we first started in VRs, we noticed that our hospital policy of inpatient falls requiring a telesitter was a really big barrier to getting people out. And so we had to readjust some of our own policies in order to help facilitate discharges. And then if you hear a care manager talk about ADA, or I'm gonna follow up in ADA, or I have to put the patient in ADA, it's our insurance, it's our SNF and adult family home placement software. We can upload the patient's profile and then those facilities get access to all of the documentation and the notes. So they can look at the patient and see if the patient is able to come to their facility or if they can match the patient's care needs. So if you hear us talking about ADA, that's what that is. If they don't have insurance, that's a really big barrier to going to a SNF. Peace Health pays for beds to be kept reserved at other facilities. We have some in Avamere and Prestige in Camas and Prestige in Salmon Creek. And so if a patient is uninsured or unhoused and has like a skilled need that the SNF can provide, we can refer those patients. We try not to use those beds for patients that will need like long-term care beds or constant, unending care, because otherwise they end up staying in that bed for a really long time. And so we try to limit it to those patients who will eventually benefit from therapy and get better and be able to go back to wherever they were living. Then on the next slide, Medicare has its own rules. So commercial payers often will do prior authorization for a SNF admission. And so the insurance company has to agree to pay for it before the patient gets to the SNF, and the SNFs will not accept the patient and start providing care until they know that they're going to be reimbursed for the care that they're providing. Medicare doesn't have a prior auth, but what they have is this 3-midnight rule. And it went away during COVID. They wanted to take the strain off the hospitals and get people out, and so they took away this 3-midnight barrier. So a patient has to be in inpatient status for 3 midnights needing to be in the hospital. They can't just be in inpatient status erroneously. In order to go to a SNF, this ended the waiver or the waiver for this ended on May 11th, and so we're already starting to see some confusion and some difficulty in understanding this. So if you hear the care managers talk about the patient status, where the coaches on the units are asking if they're in observation or inpatient, that's why. The clock for the three midnights starts when the inpatient order is put in. So if you've got a patient that was in OBS for 2 days and then they're in the inpatient on the third day, they've only been in inpatient on one for 1 day. So hospital day six would be the earliest that they could go to a SNF. The Medicare doesn't do calendar days, they do it by midnights. And so say Ann checks in at 10:15 in the ED, but she doesn't see a doctor until 1 a.m. She's already crossed 1 midnight because they go from the time the patient hits the door. If she checks in at 12:15, she has not crossed 1 midnight. And so the next midnight would be where she like has 1 midnight under her belt to go to a SNF. Does that make sense? Medicare is very hard. It's the hardest part of my job, so it's okay if it's confusing. And then on the next slide, for IPR, IPR and SNF, sometimes I feel like get a little interchangeable in how we talk about them, but IPR has a very like specific patient demographic that they're willing to accept. So the patient has to have a post-IPR plan, and often that involves 24/7 care at home. So if they don't have family that are willing to pick up that Slack or private pay for caregivers, IPR often will not accept them. They have to be able to tolerate 3 or more hours of therapy a day. If you have a patient who is, one, not able to tolerate that because of pain, IPR will not take that patient. Or if the patient is refusing to work with therapy for any other reason, they will see it as a red flag. And it takes a long time for IPR to reevaluate a patient. It's not necessarily the same thing as like they refused in the morning and then at 2 p.m. they're okay with therapy, and so like now we can go back to appointment for IPR. They will not look at the patient again because they're so busy with referrals until the next day or the day after. And sometimes what we will notice is that they, in order to protect their unit and their staff, right, they will say that patients have to have like 48 hours of no refusals, or they have to be off BiPAP for 48 hours or something like that. So when we see those really specific benchmarks in the notes, we need to be calling that out at rounds so that the day shift and night shift nurse are aligned with the goal to like get the patient up and moving, or keep them, not keep them off BiPAP, but document a really specific time that they got put on BiPAP, that kind of thing, so that we can readjust our plan. Our IPR will take people with substance use disorders, but the discharge plan gets a little shaky for a large part of that population, and so that ends up being the barrier rather than the substance use. And then with the SNFs, it's the opposite. Usually it's the active substance use that becomes the big barrier.
I would like to add, and you just said that with the interchangeable, IPR is interchangeable with SNF, part of the reason that there is such a confusion about it is because it's actually not. It's kind of saying that acute care, med surg, is the same as ICU in the post-acute world. So IPR is a level above that, and the reason why that is important is because if somebody puts in their no patient can go either to IPR or SNF, you will not receive off for IPR, because IPR is a level above, and we clearly communicate that it's not. And then the other out, the thing I want to point out is that if somebody says we can put them in IPR for a little while and then they can go to a SNF, that doesn't work. So the discharge plan cannot be a SNF, but the discharge plan could be an adult living facility or something like that.
Yeah.
Not a SNF. Just want to talk about that.
And same thing with SNFs. You can't send someone to a SNF with the idea that like you're going to find them an adult family home while they're at the SNF. They have to. They can go to a new adult family home from the SNF, but it has to already be secured before the SNF will accept them. But it's a little strange because sometimes the SNFs will accept patients if their like post-SNF plan is like a week in a motel that we pay for. So sometimes it gets a little, there's a little bit of nuance to it. Do you guys have any questions about IPR or SNPs or anything? Where am I telling? If I'm telling you something you already know, it's not me. I don't want to bore you guys. Something that we've noticed too is that like transportation can be a barrier for afternoon and evening discharges. Sometimes patients will sit for another night because no one's around to arrange their transport. So we want to empower you guys and let you guys know that you can also arrange transport for patients, and that like once we go through it, hopefully it's not as like intimidating to do that, especially for night shift. You know, I know not a lot of nighttime discharges happen, but at least this way you guys will know. So for radio cab, we always try to ask the patient if they can afford the cab. But if they can't, we don't want that to be a reason that they stay in the hospital. So Pace Health has an account with radio cab. You just have to call and give them the code and the account number, and then Pace Health will pay for it. If we're paying for a cab, there are no stops between the hospital and the patient's destination. They can't stop at a pharmacy or Burger King or wherever they want to stop. It has to be just a one cab ride. Does that make sense? They have to be independent. So radio cab can accommodate wheelchairs, but the patient has to be able to like operate the wheelchair. Radio cab's not going to do the same thing that Metro West does and help them get loaded in the wheelchair and put them in the van and everything. And it's only manual wheelchairs. I don't think that they can accommodate electric wheelchairs. We have a contract with AMR and Lyft. So if similar patient that is walkie talkie just needs a way to get home, radio cab is not available, or you know, you want an alternative option, you just call AMR dispatch and say that you need to set up a lift for a patient. The patient has to have a cell phone that can receive a text message, because they send a link so that the patient can see like what you see when you book it in the app, which is like the make and model of the car, how far away they are, what the driver's name is, that kind of thing. And then they have to be independent and like appropriate. The people that will show up are regular Lyft drivers. They're not employed by AMR. They have no healthcare background or experience. So a good rule of thumb is that if you're not willing to take that patient in your car home, don't do that to someone else, because they will not be happy about it. Radio cab and AMR often have very short ETAs. So I wouldn't use these until, or I wouldn't call these until the patient is like dressed, ready. You can wheel them straight down. They don't come into the hospital to ask for the patient. They have to meet them outside. You know, you have to choose, when you book it, you have to choose which entrance of the hospital they want to be at that. So don't call and then think that you have time to discharge a patient, because you don't. On the next slide, there's some options for wheelchair and stretcher transport. For wheelchair transport, the patient has to be able to sit up for the duration of the ride. So if it's usually like 30 to 40 minutes, it's totally fine. They have, some of them can do oxygen and some of them can't. So if you have a patient that is gonna go home on oxygen or will need oxygen for the ride, make sure you tell the person that. The people that book the rides are pretty good about asking all of their like qualifying questions, and then they'll tell you, oh, we can't take that patient with oxygen, or we don't have our own oxygen, that kind of thing. Most of them have multiple drivers. St. Chris Medivan is just one guy. It's Mike, and he owns a van, and this is his business. But as soon as Mike is booked for the day, he has no other options. He does not have another van or another driver. They will require like a transportation order form or PCS form. I'm sure you guys have seen them before. The Metro West one is blue, and the transportation order form is just very generic and white. If you know that the patient is likely to discharge after care management goes, you can always ask care management to get you a transportation order form, or we can print out a bunch and you guys can have them in your charge nurse binder or at the nurse's station, whatever works for you guys. So be thinking about that and just let us know how we can support that. For stretcher transport, they have to have a medical need for the stretcher for insurance to pay for it. So we can always pay for stretcher transport, but it's quite a bit more expensive, so we try not to do that as much. But if insurance is gonna cover the stretcher transport, you have to document on the PCS form what the medical need is, why they can't sit up in a wheelchair. You guys can sign it, the primary nurse can sign it, the care manager, the doctor, there's not, the only people that can't sign it are PTS and CNAs, pretty much. We do have a lease rig through AMR that we utilize Tuesday through Friday from 9 to 9. That ambulance is just parked here at Peace Health for us to use. They will take patients that would normally be appropriate for a wheelchair. It'll be a stretcher transport because it's an ambulance and they can't like switch to a wheelchair. But if it's a patient that would normally require only wheelchair transport, but Metro West has like a 7-hour ETA or something like that, you can always use this as an option too. And then it's always covered by Peace Health because we pay to have it available. And same thing as with the lift, you just call AMR and say, I want to book the lease rig, and then they'll ask their patient information questions. Do you guys have any questions about that? The lease rig kind of fills up a little fast, but it's nice to have in your pocket for the AED discharges because a lot of SNFs won't admit past 5 p.m. And so if this person is just going home and they just need a way to get them home, and you know, daughter's flying in tomorrow, but the patient wants to go home tonight, you could always use the lease rig for that too.
It'd be nice if you would print that out, something laminated for everybody with phone numbers and everything.
Yeah.
And then the other question is there still a swing shift or evening shift care manager?
Yeah.
What do you call on with Sarah to get that person?
So I don't know that there is, it would just be the ED care manager.
Okay.
So during the week, the way the scheduling works is that there's always two until we have them in the ED.
There used to be a swing, it used to be Debbie Dunn. Sorry.
Yeah, she's still here.
Is she here Monday through Friday, like swing shift still?
Monday through Friday, 11 to 7:30 is her shift.
Because I couldn't get her the other
day. Yeah, she's also always available on Teams too, because most of her work is going and doing the evals and then charting them at the computer. Okay. And so she's always in front of the computer at some point.
I know that, but a lot of other people do not know that, so that's another little tidbit of information to give people. I literally spent probably 45 minutes on a discharge that was supposed to be taken care of during the day the other day and did not get anything done, and the care manager put their note in pending. We cannot see pending notes.
Oh, interesting.
So if they want to start writing a note, they need to put it in the chart and keep adding to it. We can't see that, and it ends up being a lot of work. And after like calling the daughter, finding the name of the adult family home, because there was nothing in there. I had to call the daughter, get the name of the adult family home, call the adult family home, talk to two nurses, and the dean, you know, can this patient come back, talk to the doctor, do all that stuff. They come to find out that the care manager was actually still here, and I didn't find out until the lady from the home says, oh, I just talked to so-and-so.
Yeah.
And I'm like, it's 5 o'clock.
You just assume they're dead.
So it's like, I just wasted 40 minutes of my time when I should have been doing other things to get this patient out.
Yeah, no, that totally makes sense. So when we print these out with this information, I'll put the ED care manager extension on it and the hours that you can expect to reach someone.
And then maybe just let the care managers know too, we can't see your pending note. So if you put something in pending, I don't know that you've done anything.
Yeah, that's good to know, because we can see pending notes, and so we utilize that a lot too. But that's good to know that you guys can't see those, because we can definitely just start doing the pending notes. Yeah, thank you for that. Any other questions about transportation? Okay, we kind of already went over this. Yeah.
I'm confused about the lift. It's a car?
Yeah. So AMR is just the person scheduling the lift. Like, it's just a regular lift driver that shows up. But because AMR will schedule the lift, it removes the barrier of like sitting with the patient, downloading the app, attaching their credit card, blah, blah, blah. Huh. And then Peace Health pays for the transport.
Okay.
Yeah. And then this is just what we went over in the 24 hours in the Plan A. Do you guys have any other care management questions? Any way I can demystify our job? Oh, yeah, Medicare appeals. These are always very confusing. So the patients that have either a straight Medicare, which is the Part A and B, or a managed Medicare. So when it says like Humana Medicare or Regents Medicare, those are managed Medicare plans. All Medicare patients have the right to appeal their discharge. And they get told this when they get admitted by a care management assistant. And then as we get closer to their like date of discharge, we notify them again that they can appeal. So the way that it works is that so if the doctor comes in and says, "Ann, congratulations, you're medically stable, we did our job, you're gonna go home." And Ann says, "I don't wanna go home. I don't feel ready to go home. I'm worried I will fall or something." Then she is Medicare and she knows that she can appeal, so she will appeal her discharge. The appeal only starts, we have to send all the clinical information to a third party company named Keepro, and they will evaluate all of her visit and all of her information, and they will either grant the appeal, which means she can stay in the hospital, or deny the appeal, which means they agree that she's ready to go home. That process doesn't start until a discharge order is signed. So if I go in and tell Ann, "You're gonna go home," and she jumps the gun, right, and calls Keepro and wants to appeal right away, without the discharge order, Keepro won't start the appeal process. So if you have a patient that wants to appeal, we always support their right to appeal. It's a federal right that is granted to them. We never try to talk them out of it. We never act annoyed that they want to do it, nothing. I usually just try to tell patients, "I will come let you know when you can call Keepro because I'll watch for the discharge order."
I thought that a Medicare patient in OBS could not.
Yeah, OBS cannot. You have to be in inpatient status.
Yeah, so yeah. Not all Medicare patients can.
Yeah, just all Medicare patients in inpatient status. Yeah. Yeah, that's an important distinction. The way that the appeal process, the discharge order gets signed, Ann wants to appeal, we send all the information. Ann stays in the hospital while the appeal is being evaluated. So say we want to discharge Ann on a Friday and she wants to appeal, Ann will stay in the hospital until Tuesday because they only work Monday through Friday. And I think Keepro is also on the East Coast, so if it's like after 2 p.m., they don't even start it until the next day. The appeal review itself typically takes about 48 hours. It's about 2 business days for a determination. So if you think about her appealing on Friday, she's there Friday night, Saturday night, Sunday night. Monday they start working on the appeal. Tuesday they come to a decision. Maybe they let us know on Tuesday. Maybe they don't because they close. They let us know on Wednesday. And then on Wednesday, we let her know, and they agree that you should be discharged. They denied your appeal. You will be financially responsible for your entire stay starting the next day at noon. Not the entire stay, the future part of the stay. Not the entire stay, sorry. You'll be financially responsible starting tomorrow at noon. So then you think about that's Thursday at noon. So we have now gone almost an entire week just to try and get the appeal determination, right? So the earlier you know that your patient wants to appeal and letting the care manager know is really important. Yeah. So the patient is covered up until the determination. And then if I say, "And Keepro has said that you're ready to be discharged, you will start being financially liable tomorrow at noon." And then that gives Ann enough time to get together with family or resources and decide if she wants to leave the hospital or not. We don't kick them out, we just let them know that financially that you might get a bill. Right. The most important thing for you guys to know, one is that they can appeal, and two, who to tell if they say that they want to appeal. So if it's if you have a floor care manager, or if you want to Teams me or Kristen Smith, or if it's a late night appeal, you can always reach out to the SWINCHIP RNCMs. So those are your big parts of the process. You don't really have to know all the ins and outs of it. Do you have any questions about
the next day? After hours, they would teach you and you would see that the next day.
Yeah. Okay. I think that's all I have. So thank you guys.
So next we have Laura Resnicki, manager of Tower 6, talking about our nursing interventions for nursing progression.
So for nursing progression, the nursing tactics that we have implemented are using a universal nursing note that allows us to see the patient progression through nursing interventions and the patient's plan of care. We also began our morning multidisciplinary rounds, which happen at 9 o'clock each day. They're held at a whiteboard that's located at a central location on all of the units. It's visible to all staff. We're also working to improve nurse-to-patient communication through reinvigorating the use of our patient whiteboards. We are talking to the patient about the estimated discharge date, writing it on the whiteboard. We're talking to the patient about their nursing action items, writing it on the whiteboard. And this is really important so that we're having those conversations with the patient knows what to expect for each day. So we have some data here. So in March, the nurse managers and assistant nurse managers began auditing the whiteboards to see if there was an estimated discharge date on the board. And the importance of this was not just getting a date on the board, but really having the conversations with the patient. So the likelihood that the conversation was had with the patient was higher if there was an updated date on the board. So as you can see, the first about 5 weeks, we were 90% or better with that. And then at that point, we were only looking at if there was a discharge date on the board. April 16th, we began looking at not only if there was a date on the board, but was the date the correct, most updated date. So we did drop down a little bit with that. April 16th, we began auditing the whiteboards to see if the action items were on the board. And once again, the importance of this was that we were having the conversations with the patient. So we were 86% April 16th, and then we dipped down a little bit to 77% now. Any questions?
Thanks, Laura. Now we'll have Debbie Clay come up.
Quiet group today. I don't know about anybody to participate, but anybody want to take a wild guess as to why it's important to ambulate our patients while they're here in the hospital?
It affects their length of stay.
Excellent. We don't want them to decondition while they're here in the hospital. We want to make sure they're staying at their baseline level of mobility or what they came in with or improving that if we can. The longer they stay here, the more time they spend in their hospital beds, the more deconditioned they get. So yeah, it improves their length of stay and helps us get them discharged sooner. So our goal, our ultimate goal, is to have our patients ambulate 3 times a day, 25 feet, and up to chair 3 times a day. We say up to chair with meals. Quite often we would see they were NPO, so we didn't get them up. So 3 times meals is just to say 3 times, so if they're NPO, they can still be up to their chair 3 times a day. So 25 feet 3 times a day, up the chair 3 times a day is our ultimate goal. We started at, if 3 is our ultimate goal, we'll start at 1 and try to see how we're doing. So our MDR started right here, and you can see with our MDRs, we were averaging about, per charting, this is what's charted in Care Connect, 1.7 ambulations per day. And as we're starting to discuss this on a daily basis at 9 o'clock, progressing our patients through care, we can see that kind of made a small dent in it. We upgraded our goal to 2 times a day, and you can see at our current state, as of the end of April, we were at 1.9. So, and this is based on charting. So it's really important that the work that we're doing, the progress our patients are making, is also being charted in the chart to show that progression. So again, the why, when patients are left in bed and not up ambulating, they are at risk for hospital-acquired immobility harm. Every day that a patient is left in bed, they lose 5% of their mobility and their functional mobility. And assessing your patient's ability to ambulate is one of the important roles and responsibilities of the RN. That BMAT tool that we're using, knowing what our patients need to ambulate, are they using a walker, are they independent? If they're independent, just giving them that goal of walking and putting that on them, and then following up to make sure they're doing it, and then charting that in the chart. This is our charts that show by unit the number of ambulations per day that our patients are being charted as ambulating. And you can see, like on MJ2, they ended down at about 1.4 per day. 3 North, 1.5. They have a couple of above the 2 mark, but 1.5. So definitely we're seeing an improvement throughout the MDR process and the talking about it. Observation, very jaggedy there, but a lot of them above 2, and then ending at 1.9. Fourth floor, ending about 2.1. Tower 6, ending about 1.9 to right around there. So a lot of their days are above goal, though. They do a great job handling their patients on Tower 6. Tower 7, 2.6. Again, they're pretty close to their 2.0 goal and creeping up to that 3. And then Tower 8, ending about 2.0 as well. So we have a couple other tactics that we're going to start using to really encourage our patients to ambulate. We're working on some patient education that's going to be done on admission, because that's when the discharge process starts, is when our patients are admitting. So really talking to our patients, especially the alert and oriented, especially the ones that are independent, letting them know the why and the importance behind ambulating. Putting information in the unit welcome letter, and then giving them a video to, again, explain the why behind ambulation. So we're going to talk to them about it, we're going to let them read about it, and then we're going to show them about it to really get that education in there. Refusal of care is something we unfortunately deal with on a regular basis. So it's really important that our floor nurses are escalating that to U.S. charge nurses, and that we're taking action on that refusal of care. So the day one when they refuse, the RN and the provider needs to place a spiritual care consult. That's our goal, to get spiritual care in, find out, you know, have someone to talk to. Sometimes people are just, you know, they're depressed when they're in the hospital, need someone to talk to, some encouragement, some hope, and hopefully encourage them to get up and ambulate, or, you know, maybe find out some root causes as to why they're not wanting to ambulate. We want to document that refusal of care in the medical record, including the reason. Are they in too much pain? Are they afraid of falling? Are they a seawall patient, really unstable on their feet, still having active withdrawal? So it's kind of unsafe to have them ambulating. Unsafe for them and unsafe for the caregivers as well. Communicating to the provider of a refusal of care, so the provider can have that face-to-face with the patient as well, and then putting it in our end of shift summary. And then the RN is to communicate to all of you, like I said, they need to be escalating that refusal of care to the charge nurse and to the case managers. If on day two we don't see an improvement and they aren't starting to get on board with our mobilization process, we want to get a care conference together. We want to get the care manager, the unit leadership, providers, and any other leaders that would be important to have on board. Get a care conference going and get some tactics as well. We want to present that to the patient. Hopefully they will agree to the tactics, they'll agree to the plan. And then we'll just continue to document their progress through that. And if no, we'll just start planning their discharge. And then on day three, if they continue to refuse, we're going to document the refusal and again just continue to plan that discharge. Any questions on that? So charting here, it's really important. This is, you know, like they say, if it wasn't charted, it wasn't done. So it's really important that this charting piece is completed when we're ambulating our patients. I see patients ambulating all the time. We see nurses, CNAs ambulating, and it's it's really, and it gets put in the shift note. Yes, we ambulated it three times yesterday, but we're still showing nothing in the charting. So that great work, all the effort is just, it's not showing up as done. So really important that we're doing that charting. We want to make sure there's a BMAT score charted. We want to make sure that any mobility device that they're using is being charted. We want to make sure, you know, what was the activity? What were they up the chair? Were they ambulating in the hall? So the activity is which one was it, up the chair or in the hall or ambulating. Distance, and remembering that the only, those reports that we were showing, the only distance that is captured is if we charge greater than 25 feet. So if we're charting 20 feet, that distance isn't being captured in that report. It's still being captured as ambulation and it's still progress, but if you're just guessing and putting a number in and you put 20 feet, it's not gonna show up as an ambulation. So it's important that we know that they're ambulating 25 feet or greater. And if they ambulate 50 feet or 100 feet at one time and you chart 100 feet, it still just counts as one ambulation. So making sure that if they're ambulating, you know, around the unit three times in a day and each ambulation is 100 feet, that we're charting all three of those ambulations to get credit for that. And then what's their response? How are they tolerating it? And then just to reiterate here, the activity that is captured in our report is ambulating in the hall greater than 25 feet, ambulating in the room greater than 25 feet, again, the distance ambulated being make sure that's charted, and then if they are going to the bathroom, then bathroom trips usually aren't 25 feet, but it all adds up as ambulation, and it still increases the patient's stability. What's not captured is dangling, bedside, commode, bathroom use, and range of motion. It's not captured. It's still progress. It's still getting our patients mobilized. It's still having them weight bearing in a couple of those, so really using those muscles. Right now, the CNAs have a quick chart capability. They can do a one click, and all of that mobility charting comes up in one spreadsheet, so in one quick click, so they can get that charted. There's a care connect ticket in to get that feature for nurses as well. So rather than having to go from flow sheet to flow sheet to get all that charting in, or scroll all the way down to a flow sheet to get the charting in for mobility, we're trying to get it to be just a one-stop shop. You can click one click, and then all of that charting is available in that one spot. All right, and then this just shows who's mobilizing our patients. So the dark blue is the nurses, light blue is the CNAs, green is PT, and then the yellow is the mobility aid. And anytime a mobility aid or a physical therapist ambulates our patients in the halls, they are charting it and putting a distance in. So if the PT aid mobilizes the patient once in the hall, that does count as one of your ambulations. I know it doesn't show up for your charting. They have their own tab in the flow sheet that they chart under, and I have verified that their ambulations do show up on those charts. So if you see that your patient is ambulating with a PT aid, then you know that one of your ambulations is done. You can check that one off and you only have two more for the 24 hours. So one can be on day shift, one can be on night shift, and then it's not as overwhelming. But we do see that we have mostly nurses, neuro, their CNAs do a great job of ambulating their patients. But it's a team effort and everyone works together to get that accomplished.
But just as important as what we're doing is also what we're partnering with our providers to do. So they have discovered through data that 75% of our patients actually return home once they leave the hospital. So this goal that they have set is that they're going to plan to chart to get 77% of our patients back home within 0 to 4 days. So you can see that they have started out with 75.1 back in April of 22 and have activity, they have reached their, you know, close to their goal again, and they're writing right now about 74.3%. So this is an important tactic for the doctors to help us with our progression of getting people back home where they came from when they come in to see us. Another thing that the doctors are doing is using a universal provider note. The universal provider note is important for us is because it gives us a communication of what the doctor actually wants us to accomplish while they're here to progress them to discharge home. So at the bottom of the note, you'll see things like, you know, maybe we're weaning O2 or we're watching a certain kind of lab or, you know, maybe they're hematocrit, they need some blood or something at the bottom of the note that they'll have specific goals set that where we can capture action items for us as nurses to use for that day's work so that way we can progress them home. It's also great because they're also starting to put in an estimated day of discharge. Maybe if they're not ready today, they should be able to be discharged tomorrow, and sometimes those notes will capture that information in there. And from this chart here, you can see we have different provider groups. We have Kaiser, we have Family Medicine, Sound, and TBC. And you can see from here that Sound is really engaged in this process and is really trying to push that universal note so that there's a clear communication and understanding. The other groups are getting closer. You can see by the orange dot, that's TBC. They're starting to catch on with that universal note. And then Kaiser here is along the bottom, and they're starting to think, oh, this is a good thing. And then you have the, it's a yellow line, which is our Family Medicine. They kind of teeter-tottering, and then, oh, this makes sense. And so they're at the top there with Sound. So it's just a real good visual to understand that they're coming on board with this process as long as, you know, with us too. And then another thing that we're doing is the providers are doing an advanced care conversation with 45 hours of their admission, and they've set their goal at 20%. So they want to be able to complete that advanced care conversation within 48 hours of getting the patient admitted. And so you can see that they started out about 12% and they've reached 18%, so they're almost capturing that goal. I'm not sure if they'll extend it up after they've reached their 20%, but this is important so that they, as we've seen at the story that Ann shared at the very, very beginning, the gentleman wanted to go home and then we were planning some other things. So it's good to understand that if the patient wants to go home right from the very start, this is where this conversation happens with the doctor so he can relay it to us, to care management, so that we're all on the same page of truly where does the patient want to go and, you know, what's going to be best for them at discharge. And that's all.
We've got Connie Millen from the second floor, and she is going to talk about how we started this new process. Mm-hmm. Second floor was our training ground in the experimental unit.
Mm-hmm. Hello, everybody. So yeah, I'm here to share a little bit how we implemented this pilot on M2. So initially we had several key stakeholders from M2, social work, care management that came together, and we discussed the goals and action steps that were needed to develop a new process that provided us with a new desired result, right, to meet our goals, because we cannot become what we want to be by remaining what we are. So there was a change that was really needed. And again, those goals that we're really trying to achieve here are to get the patient home sooner. Nobody likes to sit around in a hospital waiting. That's the perception of the patient oftentimes, right? Another thing is that obviously we talked about how the hospital stay affects the patient, and think of harm events. You know, the patient might have a pressure injury or a hospital acquired infection as a result of a prolonged stay. We also want to make sure that the patient is not blocking a bed for somebody else and is desperately waiting, perhaps sits in the ED on the stretcher since the last 18 hours and really is hoping for a bed, right? And again, we talked about mobility and the importance of mobility. One of the reasons mobility is especially important also for the geriatric patient population is The deconditioning is really something that if you think 5% every day and they're sometimes here for such a long amount of time, young people can come back from that much more easily. The geriatric population is at risk to have a decrease of mobility as a long-term effect. So they go home, but they will not be the same at home. And it's our job to make sure that they don't decondition here. So as you can see, I put up some slides. So we had a staff meeting that was dedicated to the new MDR process and the pilot that we're trialing. We wanted to just kind of talk about with the staff, what is this all about and what are we really trying to achieve here? And so, as you can see, the idea is that we can all come together. We have a conversation rather than a report. We are developing action items as a result to really progress and take part in the process much more actively than before. We want to be able to identify barriers that perhaps before we were not seeing as clearly. I think a lot of us, just by listening today, especially to Greg, we've learned a lot, right? What all has an effect on discharging and progressing a patient. And so I can personally say I definitely learned a lot about care management and I have a whole new change perspective on it. And then we also incorporated the important roles from the nurse professional practice model. If you think of the nurse as an advocator or the nurse as an educator, especially education is key. If you look at the patient family centered care model that's up there, if you think of the patient as the center of everything we do, and they are the ones that are the decision maker, they have autonomy, right? They have to decide to say yes to the surgery, they have the right to decline it. It doesn't matter if we personally feel that the surgery in this case might be the best option for them. They have the right to decline. So knowing that our role is very much that of educator, to give them all the information so that they can make the best informed decision. And that, I hope you already all started to link in your minds right now with the whiteboard. Why is the whiteboard so important? Because it is a process that links this educational piece that we as nurses hold with the patient, right? So by putting up the discharge date, by discussing what is needed today so that you can hopefully go home, because I know you want to go home tomorrow. So these are things we need to achieve today. And can we make a plan to get you up and mobilized? Or when you're coming back from that x-ray, let's see what the doctor says. I page the doctor and we can talk to you about the results. Things like that, right? So take the patient as part of the decision-making process rather than somebody that we communicate to and share the surprising news like, oh, by the way, you're not going home, you're going to a SNF. Right? I mean, just imagine you go to the hospital with the best intent to go back home. I would always anticipate after a hospital stay that they might let me go home, to just be communicated to rather than to have the right to be part of the decision-making process is really important and a strong nursing role. So as you can see, we focus really on helping our staff understand what information is needed. And why we're doing that, the why behind it all, and the MDR process that we developed. And this little form here just don't think this is currently in use. It was just something that we developed as part of the process because we really wanted to take into account that nurses are at different levels of their professional journey. They might be a novice nurse, they might be really experienced, and a lot of things are very much known to them, and they don't have to really focus on perhaps every single step the same way. So the novice nurse might need a little bit more help. And so this document was essentially a representation of us trying to guide folks. What is needed to report out? What do we need to consider here? What do we need to think about? In the staff meeting, we also tried to have a few flow examples, discuss with the staff about what to say, what to consider, what is a barrier for a patient, what is not, how the discharge location perhaps could be a barrier linked to certain things we see. So we hear oftentimes patient goes to a SNF and we're reporting on the bowel movement, it's very important, otherwise they might not be able to go while it is not necessarily a barrier if they go at home. Things like that. So that was essentially just a little bit of a historical look back for you guys. I don't know if anybody has any questions of what we did or anything you guys would like to know. Well, thanks for listening.
Why was that happening? We were trying to dig into that. And we know that we had gone through something that we had never expected to. And that had changed the way that we look at things, the way that we do things. We were responding rather than planning. And so this NBR process, really, we wanted to try something different. It's got a little bit of the what we've done in the past, but it also has a different variation. And it's not just us that are doing this. We know that nationwide patients had been staying longer in the hospital. So a lot of hospitals right now are going through the same processes that we are, asking how do we progress our patients through their stay and get them back home or to where they were living sooner. So as we started this process on the second floor, there's always that plan, do, check, act model. So we were planning, we were checking, or we were doing, we were checking, we were acting. So once we felt like we had honed in on what process we wanted to roll out to the house, we rolled out in February. And we also have a perfect 24 hours for a patient. So what that looks like is our patients are admitted, then our night shift records patient progress in their note. That form that you had seen earlier that Connie was showing you really morphed into our universal nursing note. So then after that, we have charge to charge report, the MDR process happens, day RN records patient progression, charge to charge again, and then that repeats until the patient's discharged. Really, the MDR process is 1 hour in that 24 hours. That process is not what's making the difference in patient progression. That's not why we have seen a dip back down in length of stay because of the process. That's just the report out. And our primary nurses and our physicians are in the background, the other 23 hours of progression our patients. And so really that's how this all plays out. All of you are essential in that report out, right? You need the information for your nurses. And we know that during this rollout, a piece is a little broken. It's that primary nurse to charge nurse report. And so we lost a little bit of that. And we heard, well, the nurses aren't involved. I'm not getting the information that we need. And so we need all of you to give us feedback on how do we fix that part. We know a little bit of it as it takes time to fill out the note. And we are working on how do we make that easier. But we also sent out a survey. I think it was March that we sent this out because we wanted feedback from everybody. Tell us how you think it's going. There were some things that came out of that survey. So we needed improvement of the note. The note was confusing to staff. It was repetitive. It didn't capture what we needed to have as you were reporting out. So with some feedback, managers went out and talked to nurses, charge nurses, gathered feedback, and we revamped our note. So that has already gone live. All of you know that and interact with it on a daily basis. We also have a care connect ticket out to have information from the flow sheets flow into the note so that nurses aren't having to fill everything out. They're already charting that stuff in the flow sheets, so why are we having to
PTA on that, but it's happening in the background. Another thing that came out of our survey was needing a better understanding of the process, and that, you know, everything happened very fast. We needed to act quickly. We rolled out processes, and so now we're stepping back and saying, how do we explain what we've done and show the results that we've seen? So that's our charge in this meeting. And previous round, we found to be ineffective. Our length of stay just kept going up. We enjoyed the time we spend together in those rounds, having the nurses come in and report out. Really now, we're hoping this has given time back to the staff to progress the patient. And we just need to refine bits and pieces of it. So another thing is staffing. We heard your voice in staffing. We know staffing has been difficult over the last 6 months. We are seeing it start to slowly get better. Most of our day shift nurse positions are filled. We still have night shift that we're working on, but we have several units that have almost filled all of their night shift nurse positions. CNAs, we know we need more CNAs in our hospital. We have a CNA hiring event that's going on this week to get more staff and brought in CNA students, something we have not seen in many years. Trying to get different people, pull from different resources in the community to draw in those resources for us. And then patient mobility aids. Another thing was we need help mobilizing our patients. So we have increased from 6 to 9 mobility aids, and they're doing 10 hours versus 12 to cover more days in the week. Question? So we want to show you the results. What have we seen? What has the results given us just in the short period of time? So Bradley McKnight, intern manager of Tower 8, is going to show us.
So you guys heard an overview of the MDR process and how it works and all the heads that have come together to make it work. This is a graph that shows you patient progression. It shows you length of stay since back to December of 2022, going all the way to May of 2023. And as you can see, we did start to have a different length of stay. It was an increase, and then it's a decrease towards where we're at now. So that's a show of progression. It shows home health, in blue, green is SNF, and white is hospice. This is our readmission rate, and this is from November 2022 to April 2023. So there's been a lot of question about this. As you'll see by this graph, I'll just denote the colors. We have that dark blue is Mojo 2, orange is 3 North, purple is Mojo 4, yellow is Tower 6, light blue is Tower 7, and the green is Tower 8. So as you'll see, some of the floors have a slight increase in their readmission rate, but a lot of floors also have a drastic decrease in their readmission rate. So, I mean, as you can see, as we started the MDR process in February on, we see a lot of transition in a lot of the units. So I would say an overview looks like we are improving as a hospital and we have some room for improvement, but looking at that, we're only 3 months into the process, I think, you know, we're doing a good job. So what are our next steps? We're talking about communication and improvement with communication between the nurses and the doctors. That's our next goal. We're partnering with our sound physicians to increase that communication. What they're gonna start doing is when a provider is rounding on a unit, they will touch base with the unit, PTS, charge nurse, or staff member to let them know they are there. The staff member will then broadcast to the unit to let nurses know they are there, and this gives the nurse the ability to round with their provider if able, ask questions in person instead of paging, and discuss the plan of care with their patients. So I know that sounds crazy and a little bit much for nursing. So we're working on a way for providers to get a standard work so that they can improve that process by paging out to the nurses as they arrive on the floor without having to come to a staff member. So that's what we're working with, and we're gonna release some standard work to them for that. In terms of Vocera use, the nurses need to ensure they are logging into their Vocera and assigning their patient rooms shift and as they add the new patients. This will give providers a direct way to contact their nurses to provide updates to their patients. So we see that the providers are helping us, trying to get them asked and overall asked to improve the goals of care conversations that we have with our patients If we have providers going in with our nurses to actually discuss with the patient the plan of care, we have a higher chance of them meeting their goals for discharge and reducing length of stay. So our next steps for nursing would be to work on having holistic and complete SBAR communication to the doctors so that we can make sure that they're getting the best image of the patient so that they can get the best progression for that patient. Of course, that process is the situation background assessment and recommendation. I'm not going to read through each. You guys know what SBAR is.
Now, I have a question. Yes. Do you know, this is kind of random, but do you know if the physicians understand, like, how to call a listener on the phone?
Yeah.
And because Kaiser's good about that for the most part. And then how, at the Central Hour 7, we all wear our locators pretty religiously, and how to find the nurse on the screen. I just feel like there's some education lacking from most of, not all of the providers, on how to find your nurse.
Very, very agreed.
And how to, I mean, I know all of our assignments are slightly different. I'm trying to see if we're looking and kind of, you show me how it works at Tower 7. And I show them, you know, when you're looking for your nurse, this is how we do it. Because, you know, a lot of the new sounds don't let me know. But I feel like that's maybe something that would benefit.
The newer ones that are coming up, we'll use the Vocera and we'll call on the phone. Some of the older ones are just like, Carmanos used to just run on the floor and be like, where's Sally? You know, you can hear it from the elevators. So
we're going to work on standard work for them. So we are providing standard work. We still have that's in the works. So we're going to put it together, and that's good feedback, so we can include that information for them. So if you guys can take it into your, you know, into your hands, we're still trying to increase the rounding with the provider. So if we can get the provider in the room with the nurse, it helps so much. I know you guys know that situation where the patient is not on the same page, and then the nurse goes in there, and then we basically go into a rat race of round the corner trying to get the you know, everybody on the same page. So
how much of the preceptors going to get any of this kind of information so that they can reinforce that with new people? Because in the culture, you know, if they're not trained from the beginning, it can be hard to maybe some preceptor development around the syllabus.
That's a great call out. I think that's great. Any other questions about that?
Just with the provider, I didn't know how to slide, if I should like wait for my comment about the provider development and standard process, but just as a call out and a reminder to providers that the Voceras are speaker phones. Sometimes, hi, this is Natasha, I'm in a patient room. Goes over their head and they start their piece. And then I know, especially like with breaks, if I have a problem with a patient I'm working with, you know, a blood pressure issue, lab, pending discharge, whatever, then I personally want to speak to that provider during break, but hi, I'm Natasha, I'm on break, how can I help you? Right, same thing over the head, like the greeting just goes by the wayside. So just maybe Vocera etiquette, if we're going to be encouraging them to utilize the Voceras, we should be mindful of boundaries and etiquette.
I wish we could record people how they sound on the Vocera. Not just not pick on somebody, but just to, you know, hear themselves sometimes. Thank you, Bradley.
Following them into the room, and they just don't want to hear what I have to say, or us, we have
patient sees that you're both on board with the plan. When you think about our complex patients that may have behavioral issues, when the nurse and doctor go in there to talk together, they know that they can't play one against the other. When they were having issues with refusals of care, it helps to have the team on board. And so we are having conversations with our physician partners on increasing that communication, grabbing your nurse and rounding. Nursing also needs to go, you see your doctor on the floor, follow him in the room. And the doctor needs to be welcoming of that communication and that interaction, because it is essential for, especially, you know, for every nurse, but our newer nurses. I remember Dr. Cormanis is a new nurse. I learned how to talk to doctors because of him. And, you know, he made sure that he let me know what I needed to know to communicate that to him, especially if he had not seen his patient. And so our doctors, you know, seasoned doctors help new nurses help our seasoned nurses help our newer doctors to learn. So it really is a important relationship to have. And the SBAR format came up because we're asking our nurses to call doctors and say, hey, can we discharge this patient? Well, they may not have seen their patient, or they might have a plan for their patient. And they're thinking, why is the nurse asking me if I can discharge my patient? And that can cause friction. So having your SBAR together is really important to give all that. What's the situation? What's the background? What was your nursing assessment? And what recommendations do you have? All of those things play together. And we all have to work together to ensure that we're growing those relationships. So we do have time left. Does anybody want to role play? I'm just kidding. We were going to do that, but we know how everybody doesn't like to role play. I just thought I'd throw it out there. What other questions do you have?
I have two questions, actually, on the thing that Riley just did. Did you say that we are going to, like, the sound provider is on the floor, the charter is going to post their broadcast, this provider's on the floor, like,
so
that kind of thing, or could we just get the sound list, see who has that patient, and be like, hey, heads up, the doctor's on the floor? Because we have had trauma patients, like, we've tried this with trauma before, where we broadcast, but then they start with this patient in 31, and then this the person in 100 is waiting, they wait for like an hour and a half, and they're still over here in 29, because they're just, they would need to take forever with the patient, which is fine. But then, you know, before they do an addressing change or what happened, you know, so I just, are we broadcasting or are we just calling the nurse?
So right now what we're taking baby steps. We're asking them to broadcast because, you know, we had thought, well, maybe they can come up to the nurses because they don't know how to use the Vocera and broadcast to a unit, or maybe they don't have privileges to do that. But then there's a lot of discussion, and the ask is that the providers pick up the phone and broadcast to the unit, that they're on the unit. It might be hit and miss, but at least you know your provider's there on the unit. We're also asking them to touch base with their nurse before they leave the unit. And we're starting with sound, of course, because they are, you know, they're our bigger provider group. They see most of our patients, and then we'll start to spread. But it really is taking those small steps and getting them on board. Sometimes it's hard to get them on board with new processes. Maybe I can get to the chair to start with. But it's that pattern. It's those, the patients that we see that are like, I don't want my meds, I don't want to get up, I just want to lay in bed. And, you know, we know what we need to do for them. And so those are the patients that we really need to dig in and say, what can we do to get this patient? Maybe there's something underlying they don't want to talk to us about, that they'll talk to a chaplain about. But really it's those patterns. It's those patients that we know are going to continue to refuse care. And nursing judgment, right? We nursing judgment comes into play.
Are we working on getting more chairs? Because I know on any given unit and on, we're still playing musical chairs in Ugin area years. And we're still playing musical chairs.
Yes, we are.
And I just know that was like a goal for like, you know, most of my patients, yeah, like you said, even if they can't walk, let's get them upright.
Yeah, we are working on getting more chairs. What other questions?
Oh, I have feedback, I guess, more than anything. So as nurses, we've looked at different units. We're expected to just kind of pick up where we left. You know, you get report, you expected to go on and, you know, and take care of your patients. And I'm seeing a pattern, and with our regular core staff of care managers and social workers, when they're there from day to day, it's great. We have great, you know, handoff and continuation of taking care of our patient. But say our people are gone and we're getting floats, mm-hmm. I see an ongoing pattern of, I don't know anything. There was literally probably like 7 patients that should have been seen on Monday and possibly should have had a bed and been gone that were, did nothing. And the feedback of it is, it's just so hard to go and be like, what's going on with this? And like, we can't see pendant notes. To me, you've done nothing with that patient all day long. If you don't have a note, they tell us, we don't chart that you walk somebody. You did nothing with that patient. If there's not a chart and I can't see that you did anything and to progress their care, then I see nothing's going on. So it's really hard when, you know, as nurses, we're expected just, you float, you go, you continue, and you pick up where you left off. And I know they got a report, but when they come to the board and they can't even do rounds for one, or continue on and evaluate that patient and decide what they need and get them out, it's just really hard to see that happening. Mm-hmm. So I guess it's feedback more than anything, that I feel like if they are floats, they need to come in sometime with sometimes a better attitude more than anything. And just be like, okay, what can we do, you know, versus, they're not gonna go today.
Yeah. No, feedback is very welcome, and it is essential that we are all doing the same thing, right? We're all on board with this process because we see it is working. You know, I know readmission rates were a big question. Are we readmitting patients? We're pushing them out faster than we had in the last 2 years. You know, we have one unit that, yeah, they are a little bit higher, but the rest of them are going down.
Is that planned, that readmits to, you'll show up on that also?
So there's some
vasculars that come back, a ton of vasculars that come
back. That feedback we will bring back to our team. We meet with care management leadership every week and we talk about what can we do better. So we will bring that back. And we know that they are also watching rounds, right? You see Kathleen is roaming and she's watching rounds on different units. And is very welcome to.
She should come to a unit that has some floats.
Or on a weekend. You should see the weekend.
Certain floats in general. In particular.
And we are rounding on the weekends. The administrator on call will pick a unit, and generally it's that unit that the predicted discharges don't match the GMLOS, the geometric length of stay. And so we'll go to that unit and we'll watch rounds on the unit to see what's happening on the weekend. Because we know our discharges, they drop off on the weekends.
Well, I had one and I escalated it, Kelly, where it was the same. I was the weekend charge. We had started this process. It was very much like and it wasn't even just, learning and stumbling, because I just switched to weekdays, and trust me, I'm stumbling all over again. But it was like, oh, well, it's my only day. Well, I'm only here for a day. Well, it's my only day. And I escalated that, and that didn't happen again. Because, right, well, it's your own day here, but we can still do some things. And, I just took it to my manager.
Yeah, let us know.
I know some chart nurses do have access to pending notes, and I find it very helpful, especially throughput from ED or actively consulting with PT and just being able to be involved in that process. So I think IT might be a bridge where we
for months we didn't have anybody apply to, which is something that we have never seen before. So we're seeing us progress forward. We're seeing us come out of this post-pandemic state. We're not there yet, but we're looking at our processes, and it's really, it's